come in? Okay, great. May I have a seat? Wonderful. Quite exquisite. I know it's past curfew, well past curfew, but being as I am your next door neighbor, I've been dying to meet you. And when I say dying, I think this is third or fourth time I've been reanimated. Anyway, allow me to introduce myself. My name is William. William Clemens. I know, right? I share the same name as the professor. It's a small world. Well, not really. The Earth is quite large. It might be smaller compared to other worlds out there that have yet to be explored. But there it is. Yeah, it is odd, though. I've always wondered that, why I share the same name as the professor. Shoo. 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 Sometimes I have dreams about being a college student in an old university. But you know how they do things here. Always swapping memories and brains, limbs. I was having some trouble sleeping. So I decided to roam the halls, just like most of the patients. I'm not sure if you're the same way. This from the gift shop. I've always wanted a brown shoe. And it only cost me 3 tokens. Shoe. Shoe. Do you hear that? Exquisite. The most exquisite brown shoe I've ever owned. Just look at the craftsmanship. I have a shelf just for it, next to a little garden gnome skull and a few other trinkets. Well, like I said, I've been wanting to meet you and introduce myself for quite some time. You seem to be very popular and special. I've heard people, other patients, staff members talk about you being the one. I'm not going to be confused with Neo from The Matrix. Pretty nice fellow. But something special about you. It makes me a little jealous. You get so many visitors. Professor and Dr. Winslow, Tinfoil Hat Society. They're always making a fuss over you. Meanwhile, I get Joe, one of the other patients who's become an orderly. He's a horrible tapper. And whenever he crinkles, it's too abrasive. But he has good hand movements. I'll give him that. And it is whispering. It's very good whispering. His phonetics, his enunciation, certain words really triggers my Arkham Sanitarium method of relaxation, that's for sure. So how long have you been here? Me? Oh, I've been here since the beginning. I think. Oh wow. Can I take a look at some of your paraphernalia? Red swing line stapler. Did you purchase or rent this from the gift shop? Oh, you're so lucky. I know the guy that used to own this. We play chess together. He's a pyromaniac, though. Oh, I can see why you would have pick this up. The coveted stapler. It's beautiful. Padlock. Oh, yeah. Exquisite. Do you know the combo? No? You're practicing your lock picking skills. Well, not really picking, but... quite the collection. Some albums. A light bulb. Paper cups. I like that. I like those words. Paper cups. I like the P words. Paper cups. How about you? What are some of your favorite triggers? Some of those are mine, too. We have quite a lot in common as far as the triggers that we like. Shoo, 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 shoo. Brown shoe, brown shoe, brown shoe. So... big question. What do you think about this place? Grand old Arkham Sanitarium for mental rehabilitation. Have you had a chance to explore the place in greater depth? And when I mean depth, well, there's quite a lot of depth to this place. Places that you probably, corners that you probably don't want to go poking around in. How did it all get started? That's a good question. It all depends on who you ask. This facility is here since the 20th century. A few millennia ago now. It was built here in Arkham, Massachusetts, in the early 20th century, 1915, something like that. But it wasn't the original Arkham Sanitarium. The original sanitarium was, of course, it wasn't called Arkham Sanitarium. I forget the original name. It's probably something you could find out about in the library. Have you been to the sanitarium's library? It's quite expansive. But the sanitarium was originally built in Europe, England, during the Middle Ages, 12th century, 13th century, by a Clemens. It depends on who you ask, but some say Professor Clemens is, and his brother, quote, Brother Corvus, have been around since the Middle Ages, which makes them 5,000 years old. It's modern medicine for you. You know Corvus, the plague doctor. One of the plague doctors now. There's dozens of them. It's like their own little cult, the cult of plague doctors. There's Corvus, Dark Corvus, White Corvus, Brown Corvus, Red, I mean, every color, different species. Anyway, apparently, as one of the story goes, it depends on who you ask. And I keep saying that because you travel through one of the rifts and it starts to do something to you a little bit. And not to mention that you might end up in another alternate reality of the sanitarium. And so you travel often enough through the rifts, and you begin to forget which reality is the one true reality. Sure, you've heard of, you hold a shoe up to your ear and you can hear the gibberings and whisperings of the old ones. I haven't got mine to work that way quite yet. But the professor in Corvus, as one of the schools of thought goes, they were blood brothers, twins. Corvus, you know, born in the Middle Ages. Corvus had a more positive outlook on life and was interested in, was very creative, enjoyed cooking and coming up with his own recipes. And eventually he went to school for what today would be known as pharmaceuticals. But his brother, William, or it might have been Willem, was very standoffish, introverted. Was more interested about the mind, the workings of the human mind. And something happened. There was a fire, some tragic incident occurred, and their mother and father perished, and they may have had some siblings too. Heard it say that Margaret is actually the professor's sister, and it's a little creepy. Or some say Margaret was the professor's wife, and he was married at the time, and he lost her as well. But as Corvus and the professor overcame that apparent, as the theory goes, that tragic incident, they went their separate ways. They were brothers, close brothers when they were young. But Corvus wanted to practice medicine, and so did William, the professor. But he wanted to practice his medicine on actual people. So he helped with a lot of other colleagues, doctors, helped create the first sanitarium. And then there was a fire. And the professor left, came to the United States in the early 19th century, 20th century, and opened up the second sanitarium. And of course, as you know today, there's an Arkham Sanitarium, you know, quote, off-world, all throughout the multiverse. There's the Gallifrey, there's the GSMR, and the Gallifrey Sanitarium for Mental Rehabilitation. There's the one on LV-426. Endor. Tatooine. Almost any world that you can think of that's inhabited, there's an Arkham Sanitarium there. Brown shoe. Maybe mine's not working. Maybe it's broken. Sanitarium also burnt down once as well, but it's been rebuilt and even more state-of-the-art than before. One What about some of the faculty and staff members? Well, you know the professor. Some think he's Nyarlathotep, the crawling chaos, an elder being from another dark corner of the universe. So the theory goes among some of the patients, depends on who you ask. The professor wasn't born in the Middle Ages. Well, a human being of the professor's likeness was born, but Nyarlathotep possessed that corporeal form. But as it goes, Nyarlathotep came here to Earth. Apparently, this Nyarlathotep, this crawling chaos, this being that is fascinated by technology and conducting experiments, came to Earth back around the time of the pharaohs of ancient Egypt. Been here ever since, trying to have his plan for world domination unfold, and I guess it's worked. He's got his own chain of sanitariums all throughout the multiverse. So, and Corvus, the plague doctor, apparently he found the Fountain of Youth through experimenting, different formula, secret formula, and he's able to keep his physical form alive since the Middle Ages, and I don't think he's been possessed by any elder being or God. He's immortal because he's found this secret formula. And I think he's been using that. I don't know if you've had an IV yet, the blue liquid. I think he's been experimenting with that on some of us. You get a dose of that coursing through your veins, and you feel like so much energy and a fresh outlook and perspective on life. And then there's wonderful Margaret, the professor's wife. I don't think she's his sister. I've done a little research myself at the library. Just one of those nights, sleepless nights, just it's kind of wandering the halls, thinking about my family, my wife and her expecting child. I think she probably had the child by now, but when I was admitted here, she was expecting. Miriam is her name. We're going to call the child Abigail. But I wandered into the library one of those sleepless nights and did some research. I think Margaret and the professor, they met while they were both attending grad school at Miskatonic University. As the story goes, they went on an expedition and Margaret died. The professor, learning some methods from a fellow colleague by the name of Herbert West, reanimated Margaret, and that's who you see today. She's wonderful. Don't try to peer behind the mask or you will go insane. Or end up buried in her garden. She has a beautiful garden out there. Just past the courtyard. You go out the main entrance. You see the enormous statue of Cthulhu, who is now a doctor and a resident. Who would ever have thought that we would see our Lord and Savior awaken, risen from the depths of his eternal slumber? It's a wonderful time to be alive. When you go out the front door, front doors of the sanitarium, and make a right, and you go past the courtyard, and you'll see Margaret's garden. I knew I should have tested this before I bought it. Sometimes I think they're running a scam there in that gift shop. Oh well. It was only a few tokens, so I just have to play some more bingo. But anyway, where were we? Margaret. She's a great nurse. Great gardener, she, all kinds of things growing in her garden. You need a new arm? You see, go to Margaret's garden, get a new arm. All kinds of pods growing there. Of course, the xenomorph eggs, not to mention all the natural fruits. Vegetables. All those wonderful ingredients that go into the delicious meals that we get served here. The cafeteria. You've been to the cafeteria. Chef Corvus and Chef Dave and Chef Winslow. And probably Chef Cthulhu. Knowing how they operate around here. I'm sure you know about Cthulhu. So that's Margaret, and that's Corvus, and Professor. That's the big three. And then you have Deep One Dave. He's a deep one that they recruited from Innsmouth. I'm not really sure how they recruited him, but he's taught everyone how to speak his native language of Relayan. Have you attended his class yet? How to speak Relayan? I'm not sure if they've made that into a program yet available in the Arkham Sanitarium TV network. You're familiar with that? You get to tune in and watch some of your favorite staff members and get some update on what's going on in the world occasionally. So that's Corvus. That's Dave, sorry. And then you have Dr. Sheldon Winslow, the rhino doctor. Rescued his kind, the last of his kind, rescued by the professor. And from a faraway land, talking animals. There's a queen elephant, I forget her name. She was the ruler, but the humans started to encroach on their territory and there was a war. It was a bloody war. And once again, the professor and his crew went on an expedition and brought Sheldon and a few of his kind back here. And they're over in the animal ward, talking rhinoceros, elephant, snakes, goats, you name it. It's a whole animal farm over there. Dr. Frank Walker. He's a walker, of course. I believe the professor and company performed an experiment on Frank, helped him gain his humanity back. Humanity back. And now he's a doctor. Really nice. The only walker that I know that doesn't eat people. He's really good at cards, so be careful. Dr. Frank Walker. Then there's Dr. Al Heimer. He's a kind, older doctor. Used to be a patient. Everybody used to call him Grandpa. And he's been here long enough. He's familiar with all the treatments, so he became a, you know, got his doctorate at his age, too. It's something else, I'll tell you. He's quite forgetful, though. He's like the absent-minded professor, but a doctor, absent-minded doctor, I guess. And they have, you know, over in the human ward, you know, they have the, you know, section for the elderly, those that are suffering from dementia and Alzheimer's, schizophrenia. They really do try to make the lives better for those patients in an experimental way. I mean, they, you know, remove parts of the brain, you know, insert these memories, inject some of the Corvus's special concoction, and a lot of the elderly patients, while they still have their decaying corporeal form, start to have a live a new life. I almost forgot. There's the repairman. You definitely want to pay him a visit whenever your sleep protocol is malfunctioning, or if you happen to have a synthetic limb, anything mechanical, or even if you just need some routine maintenance, the repairman is sure to give you a good checkup and a tune-up. It's the premier repairman throughout the known multiverse. He fixes anything from humans, synthetics, you name it. If it needs fixing, take it to the repairman. Not sure where the professor found him or how he recruited him. The repairman doesn't talk too much, and there's not a whole lot of information about the repairman in the library. He's quite a mysterious figure, keeps to himself, but he does the job well. And if you need a something fixed in your room, the repairman's the one to do it. He's seen a lot. I'm sure he knows a lot of secrets. Access to the mainframe computers, access to some of the sections of the sanitarium that are off limits. Some say, though, that he has some dealings with other individuals that the professor isn't aware of, people outside of the sanitarium. Well, it's, you know, secondhand information, so make of it what you will. Who else? The Green Man. Another patient, member of the staff, don't quite know. He's a kleptomaniac, though. He's a little obsessed with the things that he steals. He used to be human, or still is. He was a victim of some accident. So they covered him in a material that is fused with his skin, because his body can't be exposed to the air. So that protective suit keeps him alive. Green Man. Speaking of experimental things of that nature, there's the bag thing. Strange creature, a human, I don't know. Another being infused with plastic bag-like material. It's sentient, but quiet. Strange experiment. The very first patient number one. Usually welcomes all the new patients. Did you get a chance to visit him? Very interesting character. Everybody here seems to be very kind. Excuse me. I don't know, maybe whoever, beginning to think whoever told me that you can contact the elder ones through the shoe. Maybe they meant black shoe, not brown. Of course, there's the painter, Rob Ross. Such a great face painter. If you ever have a moment, go down to the creek behind the sanitarium, you know, work your way over to the main building where the administrative office is. Follow trail past the gazebo, and you'll find Rob usually out there, along with many of the other patients. Usually a long line of patients trying to get their faces painted by Rob. He's a wonderful, wonderful person. there's the Man of Bats, another face painter. The two of them don't really get along too well. Of course, the Man of Bats, some call him Batman. But the Man of Bats, he usually works in the dark, alone. He's a pretty good face painter. Reminds me, I haven't had my face painted in a while. Wow. I should probably visit the Man of Bats or Rob. Sometimes I tune into the Arkham Sanitarium TV, ASTV, and watch Rob or the Man of Bats, you know, do what they do. Can't always, it's a wonderful thing that the professor has his own production crew and has this little closed circuit TV network here within the confines of the sanitarium. You get to tune in and watch your favorite person perform, especially if you don't have any visitors that day. Maybe you really love Corvus. You get to tune in to ASTV. I forget what channel Corvus is usually on. Is it 48? 17? I know they change the schedules up a lot. But, yeah. The Man of Bats, Rob Ross. There's another, there's a few patients that are quite interesting as well. Charlie Carl. He's always just laying down on the floor, scratching the carpet. Something not quite right about him. Here, do you mind if you give it a try? You just say a few things in there. All right, now, see if it'll hold up to your ear. Do you hear anything? No. It's a faulty shoe, I tell you. I still love it. Always wanted a brown shoe. Brown shoe, brown shoe, brown shoe, brown shoe, brown shoe, brown shoe, brown shoe. Brown shoe, brown shoe, brown shoe, brown shoe. Boy, Charlie Carl. Fellow. And then there's the person living under the couch. How he managed to fit under there, I have no idea. Which reminds me, I haven't visited them in a while either. Wonder how they're doing. Oh, and there's the Candyman. How can I forget everybody's favorite visitor? Ever since the disappearance of candy here, some places, if you travel through a rift, they've banned sugar, manufactured sugar. The Candyman, he brings all of us here, the sanitarium, the sweets, that we so crave and love. What does he always say? People always call me the candy man, but you can call me the candy man. I don't know why he says that. He already said that I'm the candy man, but you can call me the candy man. Something not quite right with the candy man, I think. There's Dr. Groot. Very interesting creature. Talking tree. I mean, there's tree ants from Middle Earth. Have you been to Middle Earth? You take one of the rifts there. But I don't think that's where Dr. Groot is from. From what I understand, Dr. Groot is also a superhero. For the Guardians of the Galaxy. Part, superhero, part doctor. Who would have thunk it? And then you have the Tinfoil Hat Society. They have an office here. And now you have to travel through a rift to get to their main headquarters. I think it's run by Commander Timothy Timmerman. And there's the Cardboard Confederacy. I forget that gentleman's name. Are you a member of the Tinfoil Hat Society or the Cardboard Confederacy? Quite a few interesting little groups that you can join if you like. Of course, just travel through a rift. You know how the rifts work. You know what a rift is, right? Just a portal through time and space. Once you learn how to access it with your mind, you can travel through it, go anywhere you want. Of course, you can go anywhere you want here at the sanitarium. So much to explore. I mean, you have the cafeteria, all the vending machines scattered throughout, all the different treatment rooms where they perform ASMR, Arkham Sanitarium method of rehabilitation or relaxation or remediation, whatever R word you like. Still nothing. There's the gift shop, there's a library, fitness center, the pool, the arcade with all the classic arcade games from the 20th century. Pac-Man, Miss Pac-Man, ER Kung Fu, Elevator Action, Space Ace, Dragon's Lair, Commando, I think. Wizards and Warriors, the one where you wizard needs food badly. That one, I forget the name of it. Galaga. Pinball machines. And there's bingo every Wednesday night. Yeah, I think it's every Wednesday night bingo. Sometimes they televise that too on ASTV. And they're always expanding. And the place is always shifting. I swear the professor has visited the dark city and learned something from there, because the building always seems to change. Hallways, one hallway yesterday leads somewhere and today it's going to lead somewhere else. Of course, they have a candy store too, stocked by the candy man. Well, I hope I didn't talk your ear off. You still have them on. I tend to ramble a bit. But I hope that gives you a little bit of an idea behind all the wonderful, excuse me a second. Depressing. Anyway, I'll have to talk to the professor about this. But yeah, I hope that gives you a little, idea about the different cast of characters, as you might say, that live here, work here. Everyone just wants to take care of you, really. Harvest that energy that you. It's created when they perform treatments on you, perform some experimental surgery, give you some wings, tentacles, a tail, mandibles, spider eyes, what have you. I just want to help you, evolve into a higher being. I think it's time for me to get back to my room. So it's a pleasure meeting you. And I hope to see you around the halls, or maybe at the cafeteria, have lunch together. Yeah, maybe some bingo, go down the creek, take a walk in the woods. Or maybe go get buried in Margaret's garden together, right next to the limbs and the watermelons and the pineapples. Okay, well, I have to get back to my room before someone finds out that I'm missing. So, again, it was an honor and a pleasure to meet you. And hope to see you around soon. Take care.